Lichvod, Rabbi Riskin, Shi Badel, Lechayim Aruchim, and in memory of Lucy, Maya, and Rina D, Hashem Yimkom Damam. If I can think of one attribute that really unites unites the people we are honoring today, it would be the attribute of community building, right? All of these people, in their very different ways, were all deeply involved in community building, and I am a beneficiary, and my community of Efrat are beneficiaries of all of their efforts of community building. So I thought it would be appropriate today to look at a topic which I think lies at the heart of a discussion about community building. It's a halachic topic. I'm gonna pull up on the screen here. It's a halachic topic, which I think has philosophic ramifications in terms of how indeed we, sorry, pulling up to the top here, how indeed we can, how much room we have within halakha to allow for halachic pluralism, for variant minhagim, variant practices, and on the other hand, what are the limits on that? It happens to be that it's during this time period, it's during Sefirat HaOmer, it's in the context of talking about the minhagim of Sefirat HaOmer, that the Shulchan Aruch, the Rama in the Shulchan Aruch happens to discuss this. It's somewhat of a coincidence that it is a timely conversation, but I decided I would take advantage of that coincidence and delve into the sugya. Background, as we all know, this period between Pesach and Shavuot, Min HaTorah, the Torah, there's a mitzvah of Sfira, of counting. The Torah doesn't give much like, just presents the mitzvah of counting and without any sort of bias, the implications and the traditional understanding of that counting honestly has a note of optimism in it. We are counting, whether it's from an agricultural perspective, as we are counting forward from the beginning of the season, and moving up to the period of Bikurim, of our first fruits, whether it's from a more spiritual perspective of counting from Yetziat Mitzrayim to Matan Torah, there's an inherent optimism in the mitzvah of counting, it would seem, which ironically then the Gemara tells us that ironically this period of I would say again organic optimism in counting ironically became a period of mourning. The Gemara tells us in the aftermath of the death of Rabbi Akiva's students during this period, and we know later in history of other tragedies and crises that sort of mounted on this period and turned it away from being a period of optimism and more towards a period of mourning. So the Shulchan Aruch in Siman Taf Tzadi Gimel is discussing that element, the mourning element of this period. And here we're moving into Sif Gimel, Yeshno Hagin Lehistaper, Barosh Chodesh Iyar, V'Ta'ut Hu Biadam. The practices, the mourning practices discussed in the Shulchan Aruch, is to refrain from getting married and from taking haircuts during this period. The Shulchan Aruch says there are people who have the minhag to take haircuts on Rosh Chodesh Iyar. They take advantage of Rosh Chodesh as a respite. The Rosh Chodesh overrides the mourning customs, and therefore take haircuts on Rosh Chodesh. The Shulchan Aruch himself says ta'utu bi'adam. He believes that this is an error, that Rosh Chodesh does not override the period of mourning. Haga, the Rama of Moshe Isserles, in his glosses on the Shulchan Aruch, says mihu. However, it's a little less straightforward, I think, because there are actually variants minhagim in terms of this period of mourning. Baharbe mekomot, he says, no hagin liyistaper ad Rosh Chodesh Iyar. In many places, the minhag is to take haircuts not specifically on Rosh Chodesh Iyar, but up to Rosh Chodesh Iyar. In some places, the minhag is not to start the period of mourning right away with the beginning of Sefirat HaOmer, not to mire Nisan in a period of mourning, but rather to take haircuts up to Rosh Chodesh Iyar. V'otan, those people who follow this practice, lo yisapru milag ba'omer ve'elach. Those people will continue not to take haircuts post Lagba Omer, because their period of mourning of 33 days will continue, since they've only started at Rosh Chodesh Iyar. It will continue, he doesn't say this explicitly, but it will continue up to the Shlosh Yimei Hagbala, up to the three lead-in days to Shavuot. Afo Pishim Mutar Listaper B'Lagba Omer Ba'atzmo. He says that for this, these people who follow the latter period of mourning, they are allowed to take haircuts on Lagba Omer itself. Lagba Omer does offer a hiatus for the mourning period, but the mourning period then continues afterwards again until the run up to Shavuot. Botan mekamot shenohagin listaper milagba omer ve'elach, and in those places where the custom is to take haircuts from Lagba Omer and onwards, lo yistapru klal achar Pesach ad Lagba Omer. So those people in those places should not take haircuts at all after Pesach up to Lagba Omer. Right. So he's presented two options: either starting right away and including the period from Pesach through Lagba Omer, or yes, taking haircuts up to Rosh Chodesh Iyar and then starting the period from Rosh Chodesh Iyar up to Shavuot, with a hiatus for Lagba Omer. Two different minhags. It is the next line that I want to focus on. Lo yinahagu b'ir achat miktzat minhagze u'miktzat minhagze nishum lo titko tedu v'chol shakein she'ein linhog heter b'shtehen. Even though the Ramah, unlike the Shulchan Aruch, the Ramah has said, no, it's okay. There are multiple minhagim, and some people will be taking haircuts on, you know, Kafet Nisan, and some people will be taking haircuts on Kaf Iyar. That's okay. We can live with, like, different minhagim. Different communities are going to practice these customs of Avelut in different ways. That's fine. But within one community is his caveat. Within one city, we should not have some people following this minhag and some people following this minhag, because this would be a violation of a prohibition of what he calls lo titko didu, based on the pasuk. Which reads as such in Devarim Yedalid. The Magen Avraham, again, kind of jumps on this opportunity, as I am. The Magen Avraham says, interestingly, this prohibition of lo titko tedu does not get anywhere its own siman in the Shulchan Aruch. There's no place where the Shulchan Aruch says, prohibition of lo titko tedu, here's the definition and here are the parameters. So the Magen Avraham, commenting here on the Shulchan Aruch, says, I'm going to take advantage of this opportunity where it's mentioned in passing in the Ramah, and I'm going to tell us more about the definition of lo titko tedu. So he quotes what he says is the primary source for this prohibition, which is a Gemara in Yevamot. We are in Yevamot because there's actually a machloket, a very serious machloket, a machloket with serious ramifications between Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai about the definition and parameters within Yibam and who is obligated and who is not. We're not going to go into those details, but it is a machloket which has serious ramifications in terms of what marriages are permitted or not, which could, in theory, have created really an inability for the schools of thought of Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel to intermarry, to marry one another. The Mishnah here tells us that despite their significant differences in the laws of Yimum, they did continue to marry one another. And it is in that context, again, of a place, of a very serious place, of variant halachic practices and trying to figure out how they can coexist, that the Gemara in Yevamot starts to talk about this prohibition of lo titko tedu, which dictates that those definitions of, again, the coexistence of variant practices. We're going to look specifically at a piece in Yevamot that doesn't talk about Yibam, but actually talks about perhaps, I would say, a less weighty topic, the topic of reading Megillat Esther. It's not Hatam. The Gemara in Yevamot quotes a Mishnah in Masachet Megillah. Megillah nikrit b'chad asar, b'shnei masar, b'shlosha asar. The Mishnah Megillah offers five possibilities for when the mitzvah of Megillah Esther can be fulfilled: on the 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, or 15th day of Adar, not earlier, not later. The Mishnah continues, not on the passage on the screen here, but the Mishnah continues to explain. We are familiar with the 14th as the primary date for Purim, the 15th as the date in cities that were walled in the time of Yehoshua, most notably for us in Yerushalayim today. But in additionally, the Mishnah offers the possibility of reading Megillah on the 11th, 12th, or 13th day of Adar for people who dwell in outlying villages and might need the support of the bigger cities of days of gathering in bigger cities in order to create the community and to have a community of literate people who are able to fulfill their mitzvah of reading Megillah. And so those people, we take advantage here of what the Mishnah refers to as the Yom Kinisa, the day of gathering. This is actually a financial idea. There's a market days on the Mondays and Thursdays are the traditional market days when those people who live in the outlying villages would go for the major market days to the cities. And so in order to make this mitzvah of Megillah accessible to them, we allow them to, since you are gathering anyway on those Mondays and Thursdays, we will allow you on the Monday or Thursday prior to Yudalat Adar, whether it falls out on 11, 12th, or 13th, we will allow you whichever day is most convenient and accessible to you, just prior to Yudalat, we will allow you to fulfill your mitzvah then. Again, in an effort to make this mitzvah as accessible as possible, so we'll allow different communities to read on different days. Amar Le Reish Lakish to Rabbi Yochanan. Reish Lakish says to Rabbi Yochanan in response to this Mishnah, Ikre kan lo titgo didu, lo ta'asu agudot agudot. He says, I would call this Mishnah, which allows for multiple practices in terms of reading Megillat Esther on different days in different communities, I would call this an instance of a violation of Zoram Yedalid lo titgo didu, which I'm interpreting. It is very, and there are other completely different interpretations of this pasuk, but Rabbi Reish Lakish is saying, don't we understand, isn't one of the interpretations of this pasuk that lo titgo didu comes from the shorash aguda, meaning group, and that lo titgo didu means that you, there's a prohibition of creating splinter groups. We should not break apart into separate groups. So how can we have, I know it's in an effort to make the mitzvah more accessible, but how can we create a reality where we're actually having different communities perform the same mitzvah on different days? Isn't that splintering? The Gemara then proceeds to go into a lengthy and somewhat complex discussion about the parameters of lo titgo didu. We're going to look at we're going to jump ahead a little bit to the end piece and look at the technical halachic parameters. I would like to suggest that even though, again, we're looking at technical halachic parameters, what's being raised by this discussion of, wait a minute, on the one hand, we have this tension between a Mishnah, and the Mishnah seems to be a paradigm of pluralism, right? We can have multiple behaviors, different days for different communities because we recognize the needs of different communities. We can have pluralism in halacha with a goal of greater accessibility. And Reish Lakish is pointing out that, but this competes with another value, the value of lo titgo didu, the value of unity, that we actually don't want to splinter. So again, we're going to look at specific halachic parameters, but I would suggest that this halachic debate has ramifications more like philosophically in how we look at community and how we do walk that tightrope and, you know, pull that tug of war, pulling the rope in the direction of pluralism and accessibility on the one hand, and on the other hand, competing with sometimes the value of unity on the other hand. So let's see how the Ba'alei Halacha kind of walk this tightrope, and hopefully that can help us think along the lines of walking the tightrope in the broader sense. Again, jumping ahead a little bit to the next daf in Yevamot, Abaye and Rava are going to again give us specific parameters and narrow the scope of this prohibition. Amar Abaye, Hachi Amrinan, Lo Titgo Didu, Kagon Shtei Batei Dinim, Ve'ir Achat, Halali Morim Kidibrei Beit Shammai, V'Halali Morim Kidibrei Beit Hillel. Abaye says, this is what we mean when we say Lo Titgo Didu. We mean an instance when there are two Batei Din, two courts in one city, Some follow the position of Beit Shammai, and some follow the position of Beit Hillel. Aval, shtei batei dinim b'shtei ayarot, but if we have two different courts in two different cities, leit lanba, then we have ein lanu, right? We have no issue at all with this. Two different cities. So here, according to Abaye, this is the tightrope. This is the balance that we can, we recognize that different cities have different practices. And that's the multiplicity within halacha, that we allow for various minhagim of different cities. But within one city, Abaye says, within one city, we don't want splinter groups. Cities have to have coherence minhagim. Rava comes along and disagrees. Amarle Rava, v'ha Beit Shammai u'Beit Hillel k'shtei batei dinim b'ir achat ami. He says, no, disagreements between Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel are like two batei din within one city, right? They totally coexisted. They intermarried. Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel are not like two different cities, but even within one city, we can acknowledge that we can have two batei din. We can have two court systems. We can have two rabbis. We can have two communities within one city. And they could have variant minhagim. Ella amar Rava ki amrina lo titko to do kagon beitin beir achad plag marin kidivrei Beit Shammai uplag marin kidivrei Beit Hillel. No, he says. Rava says definition of lo titko to do is when you have one beitin, one shul, one community within a city, and within the community, within the beitin, half are following Beit Shammai and half are following Beit Hillel. Aval shtei batei dinim b'ir achat. But if we have two distinct batei din, two separate courts, two separate poskim within one city, leit lanba, then we don't have a problem. We can acknowledge and respect and recognize that we can have multiple batei dinim in different cities making different decisions, and they can coexist. But within one beit din, under the jurisdiction of one beit din, that's where we have to toe the line. Lo titko to do. We can't splinter within that community. I'm sure we can all think of instances where within our shul, within our community, there was some sort of halachic debate which turned into real conflict and maybe sometimes caused actually break off splintering groups. That's according to Rava, that's what Lotutgoda do is trying to prevent. It's trying to prevent splitting off within communities. But if we already have distinct communities, whether it's two separate cities or even two separate communities within a geographic city, that's okay. We recognize that the we have room for that type of complexity. Bringing this conversation back to Kriyat Megillah, some of the Rishonim are saying, wait a minute, how can we have, right, within one community, again, the villagers are going to come to the city, to the Yom Knisa, on, let's say, on a year that Yud Zalat Adar is on a Wednesday. They're going to come Monday prior to that on Yud Bet Adar, and they're going to read Megillah on that day. And the people who live in the city can't read Megillah that day. They can't fulfill their mitzvah Megillah that day. They're going to have to wait 2 days. So within one city, this is actually within one city, we're going to have two different days of reading Megillah. The Rishonim deal with it in different ways. Some of the Rishonim suggest, no, the Yom Knisa does not mean the villagers come to the cities to read Megillah. It means that they're going to gather within their villages to read Megillah prior to Purim. Others say, no, they're going to come to the cities, but that's okay because they're going to be their own kind of sub-community, their own Beit Din within the city. The Magen Avraham on our, going back to our context here, our original context of Sefirat HaOmer, the Magen Avraham says, quotes the Rush here, and the Rush says, when we look at Megillah, really we do have an instance where you're going to have in one city village dwellers who are visiting the city reading on one day and city dwellers who live in the city reading on a different day. And that's okay, because he draws a distinction and he says, this is not an instance where we're creating splinter groups that are machloket. We're not creating splinter groups where each group is looking at the other and saying, no, you've got it all wrong. Do it my way. We're actually creating here splinter groups where everyone understands that what he says is hamakom gorim, right? Our place, or I will broaden it to say our context and our needs are different. And so the people who live in the city see the villagers coming on Monday prior to Purim, Purim, and they see them reading Megillah in their city, which is not Purim yet for them, but they see that the village dwellers, and they look at them and they don't say, no, you're doing it all wrong, or no, you're creating conflict. They look at them and they say, we understand that you live in a different type of community and that your community has different needs, and we respect that within your community, you're going to do things differently. So it isn't, in fact, loaded go to do. It's not going to cause splintering. It's going to acknowledge difference where difference exists, because we do sometimes live with different realities. That is different. He says, that's not loaded go to do when hamakom gorim, when we all see that we bring different minhagim from our different communities, which had different needs and therefore developed differently, and we can maintain those and coexist with those. That's not the same as finger pointing and conflict, conflict causing. Fast forwarding and returning to our Sefirat HaOmer. So the Ramah suggests that yes, there are very minhagim in different communities for different reasons, were pulled in different directions in terms of when to implement the customs of mourning within their communities, and that's okay for different communities to have those different practices. But he is afraid that lo tidgo dezu, that when we come together in one community, that is going to create conflict, and someone's going to say, wait a minute, how could you possibly be taking a haircut today? Isn't it prohibited? So for the Ramah, this would be a case of within one city creating conflict by having different minhagim. Fast forward to the 20th century, and Rav Moshe Feinstein is asked in New York. He's living in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, and he is asked, wait a minute, my minhag is to keep the first period of Sefirat HaOmer, but I'm invited to a wedding, which is at the end of Nisan, by a family who are keeping this latter half of Sefirat HaOmer in terms of the customs of mourning. Is it okay for me to attend the wedding, which is following the opposing custom? Rav Moshe Feinstein here suggests there's a poignant element to this, but there's also a realistic element to this, and an openness to this position. Rav Moshe Feinstein says, you know what? Here I am, he says, here in Brooklyn or in Manhattan, he says, what is Minhag HaMakom? And again, the poignant element to this is, he says, I'm looking at my neighbors here on the Lower East Side of Manhattan, and my Minhag is not the Minhag of the Lower East Side of Manhattan. My Minhag is the Minhag of my community from Eastern Europe, and my neighbor's minhag is not the minhag of Lower East Side of Manhattan. It is the minhag of his community in Eastern Europe, and perhaps another neighbor is following a minhag of his community in North Africa. And so the entire concept of having a minhag hamakom, of having one minhag, has sort of been broken down. We can look at this in a very positive light, and certainly if we transfer this to Eretz Yisrael, we definitely see this happening in the sense of kibbutz galiot, right? That communities are coming together, and we, on the one hand, want to maintain the richness of each person bringing their prior communal minhagim together. And on the other hand, we don't want to create a lo tidgo dezu, a splinter group type of environment. And so this question of this balancing act between lo tidgo dezu and splinter groups versus the with the value of unity, on the other hand, the value of accessibility and pluralism, that line, he says, becomes very different in a world where we know that our communities are really these mergers of communities. That is really the story of Am Yisrael in Galut, is that communities are, and certainly post-emancipation, and then tragically post-Shoah, our communities are no longer these carefully defined communities and mixes. And so Rav Moshe Feinstein kind of extends the concept of the rush and says, it's not lo tidgo dezu if everyone can look at one another and say, like, oh, isn't that interesting? Like, we can be open to that. We can have a community that allows you to maintain your minhag and allows me to maintain my minhag, and we could be neighbors in the same community. So the principle that the rush establishes of kind of limiting lotit godudu to places of when there are seeds of tension, and instead being able to kind of balance towards the position of pluralism. I had said at the outset that it's kind of a coincidence that it happens to be that there are multiple minhagim when it comes to Sefirat HaOmer, and so it happens to be that the Rama mentions the principle of lotit godudu in this context, and the Magen Avraham says, if it's mentioned here, I'm going to talk about it. And I really do believe that it's coincidence, but I would say that it's kind of a poetic, there's a poetic nature to this coincidence, that specifically in the Siman, in the Shulchan Aruch, which is discussing the minhagim of Avelut, the practices of mourning, and we all know that the backdrop to the mourning is the death of Rabbi Akiva's students. The Gemara tells us because lo nahagu kavod zebazeh, the students of Rabbi Akiva were not able to create an environment of respect for one another, and that, according to the Gemara, is what led to the death and leads to this period of mourning. And so maybe it isn't coincidence after all that the Rama says. Specifically here, when I'm talking about minhagim that are in place, in order to mourn the loss of a community, as a result of internal conflict. And so specifically when I am in the process of mourning that loss is a place where I should be super on guard not to promote a further environments of low nahagu kavod zebazeh. So perhaps this is exactly the right moment in our halachic annual cycle. The moment of Sefirat HaOmer is exactly the right moment to think about the idea of nahagu kavod zebazeh, of creating an environment of respect, which tries to figure out how to maintain lotit godudu. We don't want to break apart into splinter groups. How can we create an environment which allows for multiplicity of minhagim and allows for the richness of pluralism within halacha, that sometimes there's machloket and sometimes different communities will embrace different positions? And how can we do that all under the rubric of lotit godudu, allow that multiplicity of minhagim without the fear of splinter groups, without the fear of lo nahagu kavod zebazeh? So ultimately, this, I believe, is the challenge of this period in the Jewish calendar.